could not start a match. Oh no, not that. All right, guys. So, hi there, it's Cthulhu. I did a similar stream like this before, where I was just showing people how exactly to easily collect Dragon Balls. Right now, I'm going to actually attempt to collect all 7 Dragon Balls so that I can show everybody what it looks like when Shenron gets summoned. Alright, so just from the top, we're going to quickly check and see what items we have already. Well, it looks like we have no Dragon Balls. 0 bells. Alright, that's fine. When I signed in, I thought it said it gave me the 5-star Dragon Ball, but that's okay. I'm perfectly fine doing this an egregious amount of times. Whatever. It's all good. Okay, so if you've watched my other streams or videos for this before, basically we're just going to keep hammering away at the fourth quest and fighting the time patrollers that hide there in hopes that they will have a rare item drop, that rare item being one of the 7 Dragon Balls. So the trick to this is, because those characters are based on your level and I'm near the level cap, is that you want to have a strong team. Beautiful. So I was trying to come up with topics to discuss during the stream of this. I figured it would be interesting to talk about the idea that the Dragon Ball series in general is based around the conceit of a Deus Ex Machina being the 7 Dragon Balls and their ability to just grant the user any wish. Which is, I'm not sure if there is anything like that in the original source material of Journey to the West, which is an old Chinese episodic story about a priest and the demons he befriends and their quest to return some sacred Buddhist scrolls from India to back to China. Because I think that's my understanding of what that whole story's about. Anyway, good times. I'm just probably rambling myself, and that's okay, because, yeah, there's nobody watching. That's perfectly fine. Anyway, early on the stream, not worried about it. But there seem to be a lot of anime shows that the core conceit of the show is some sort of a Deus Ex Machina, or what that term actually means, Latin for God from the machine. It's actually, was coined in Greek stagecraft and referring to when a god character would be introduced in a play, typically, like, lowered down from the rafters or ceiling or whatever on a crane, or being raised up through the floor of the stage. He has some sort of a riser system. Basically, the term, as it's used today, refers to a plot device that just solves a major problem. Typically, what's viewed is when a writer paints himself into a corner and there's no real way out. Alright, we are looking at the materials that we gained. Just material items, okay. So, that's alright. Awesome. One of these assholes has a key item. Yep, and there's our first key item. Alright, perfect. And I don't necessarily know if, based on the escalation of the Dragon Ball universe, if the Dragon Balls themselves technically count as a Deus Ex Machina. I mean, there have been several instances where you could call what happens in the scripts of series Deus Ex Machina style events. Like the fact that Namekians can just create Dragon Balls. I mean, the whole Frieza saga with the advent of the Namekian planet Dragon Balls being able to grant three wishes rather than standing one. And essentially, between the two sets of Dragon Balls, unmaking everything that happened in that series. And it's kind of silly. Oh yeah, I turned character audio off in these games because I was not sure I wanted to deal with the copyright strikes for actual voice acting from the show in any of my streams or videos that I do on this game, because I love this game a lot. I love the Dragon Ball series a lot. I still need to get caught up on Dragon Ball Super. Heard decent things about that, and unfortunately I just wanted Team Resurrection F. I did watch Battle of the Gods though and thought it was a really good movie. I'm trying to think of what other shows really utilize some overpowered device. Alright, so we got our one-star Dragon Ball right there. Well, I mean, the entire core conceit of Death Note revolves around a character with literally the power over death itself. And I suppose you could call the discovery of the second Death Note in that series is some sort of Deus Ex Machina, because it gives the lead character, our pro-slash-antagonist, the way out of a lot of his problems. that's not quite right. I suppose something like when you need a villain to be strong enough to do something really destructive, like the Infinity Gauntlet and the Marvel Universe being acquired by Thanos. That's an interesting little turn of events where, in order to attempt to woo death, he kills half of the universe. I'm not sure. I don't remember how that all resolved itself. Somehow Thanos lost control of the gauntlet, and someone was able to undo what he had done. Let's see. Yeah, that's a real interesting thing. Team in the Marvel Universe. Well, I guess the Marvel and the, I don't know if it's the DC property universe, since it was in the Vertigo books, the whole Sandman thing, but death is consistently personified in comics, well, at least in the two major publishers of comics, but counting Vertigo as DC proper, which is technically not, but for the sake of this argument, I will. Death is personified as a female in these works. In the traditional Marvel Universe, Death is frequently depicted as a female in black or purple robes with a skeletal face. And in the Sandman books, Death is actually Sandman's younger sister and is depicted as kind of a, honestly, like a gothic, and darkly garbed 20-something. God, the whole Marvel death thing's pretty interesting. Just the fact that two major characters in the Marvel Universe are infatuated with and technically are loved by death. Thanos is obsessed with and loves death, and literally goes through attempting to destroy the universe or subjugate it in one way or another in order to win Death's affection. And Deadpool later on falls in love with Death after having several near-death experiences, which brought him close to the character of Death itself. Just the idea, like, if you can, Google search Marvel Comics Death, and you're basically gonna see the Grim Reaper from Castlevania with boobs. I mean, that's what it is. It's a really weird, almost unsettling, well, it is very unsettling image. Alright, and we got a key item on that one. We're actually doing really good on this, because typically, not every one of these is gonna give you a key item drop. Oh man. I don't know what else happened to me recently. I was home alone one night after work and trying to write a short story about a martial arts tournament, getting back to Dragon Ball Z themed stuff. And I've been looking into different films and stuff that I want to research, just, you know, for the purposes of writing something, because it's kind of a funny take on, like, 80s martial arts tournament movies, my story. So I ended up watching Jean-Claude Van Damme's directorial, I think it was his first directorial attempt, maybe his last, a film called The Quest. It's a weird spiritual successor to Jean-Claude Van Damme's highly regarded, in my art, is probably one of his best films, Bloodsport, another martial arts tournament movie. The Quest is really weird, and it's a period piece, and Jean-Claude Van Damme plays a French-American street clown who takes care of some orphan children and attempts to win a martial arts tournament in order to get money to take care of these street urchin kids. It's a weird movie. Roger Moore and James Remar are in it. It's bizarre. If you have an HBO Go account or anything like that, HBO Now, whatever, that non-cable HBO streaming thing is, just definitely check that out if you have a free minute. Oh yeah, getting back to Deus Ex Machina events, I'm pretty sure it was, I don't know why this just came to me, because I was looking up Power Rangers stuff, because we've been doing some Power Rangers streams on the FSG channel and on Corey's Twitch channel, Psychosis 51. Just trying to get people hyped for the new Power Rangers movie. I was watching some stuff, I think it was on a Watch Mojo list or something like that, but they were talking about great moments in Power Rangers, in the Power Rangers series overall, and apparently, I think it was the end of Power Rangers in Space or the end of Power Rangers Lost Galaxy, it was thought to be the send-off episode for the whole series as a whole. So I think it's the Red Ranger of the Power Rangers and Space Rangers finds Zordon, the original mentor to the Mighty Morphin Power Rangers, in prison somewhere, and there's this giant battle going on where, like, all these different iterations of Rangers and all these different villains from over the years are all fighting all over the universe, and in order to stop everything, the Red Ranger from Power Rangers in Space has to shatter Zordon's energy tube that he's stored inside of, in order to disperse his energy throughout the galaxy and thus take away the powers of all the evil beings and revert them back to normal people, slash creatures or whatever. It's this giant moment, but I watched that, and then I ended up watching the Mighty Morphin Power Rangers movie. So, okay, that shattering of the Worlds tube is a clear deus ex machina. That's one reason it came to my mind recently. Watching that, and then watching the Power Rangers movie, the first one, where Ivan oozes this villain that gets released and goes after Zordon and basically takes the Rangers' powers away from them by destroying the command center and shattering Zordon's energy tube, which enfeebles him and gives him a finite lifespan because the tube is acting as his life support. So he broke the tube open and his evil wasn't unmade or anything, so wow, that's just a big old contradictory point. Material item. Yeah, we didn't get the item there. Oh well. I'm just gonna finish this mission out for the sake of getting experience. Yeah, if this ends up getting ported over to YouTube or anything like that, or if anybody does actually want to jump on the text of this later or leave comments, just tell me if you have any fun Deus Ex Machina things that you've noticed in media. It's a fun little exercise sometimes just to think about fun ways that writers have tried to get themselves out of stuff. Oh man, what else has been going on? Oh, I'm super excited because Lucha Underground is going to be coming to Netflix. I adore that show and I need to get caught up on that desperately. If anybody is unfamiliar, Lucha Underground is on the El Rey Network, which is Robert Rodriguez's own personally curated channel, so you'll see a lot of movies that he puts up and original series, which pretty much is From Dusk Till Dawn, the series, and Lucha Underground. As far as I know, those are the only two original pieces of programming for the channel, which is fine. That's all you really need. Yep, no Dragon Ball. Lucha Underground is essentially if the WWE was just allowed to do literally anything, any crazy ass thing that they wanted with their storylines. There's a dragon man in Lucha Underground. There's a guy from space in Lucha Underground. There's a guy who is seemingly his own weird version of the Grim Reaper after surviving a devastating earthquake in Lucha Underground. There are guys wrestling in Lucha Underground who have actually been UFC fighters and other stuff. There's all sorts of crazy shit going on in Lucha Underground. There's a guy who is obsessed with breaking arms as a sacrifice to his master. He turns out to be someone in the regular cast of Lucha Underground. Oh, that show is fucking crazy. There are comics set in between seasons of Lucha Underground. It is such an insane show. A character
literally got banished and then fought his way back onto the roster. And it's just like, it's for a wrestling program, it is underground. It is literally it's the Outback Steakhouse of wrestling programs. It's no rules, just right. Girls can wrestle guys. There's a little person on the regular roster and wrestles anybody at any time. It doesn't matter. They're regularly just insane three-way tag match kind of things. Just all sorts of batshit stuff happens on this show, and it is worth a watch just for all the craziness. A guy gets blinded, and then Snake Plissken, Solid Snake eye patch becomes a part of his regular guard. Oh, so much cool stuff happens in that show. But I adore it. It's thanks to the Super Best Friends that I fell in love with that show and heard about it. So thank you, Matt and William, for introducing me to Lucha Underground. Alright, we got another Dragon Ball, guys. And I think we're fine. We're still fine. Okay. What the hell else was I gonna talk about? I gotta think if there was a Deus Ex Machina. Sudden appearance of Christian Grey after okay, spoilers for 50 Shades Dark. The lead character is just crestfallen after her sadist lover gets in a goddamn helicopter crash. And news outlets are covering it and talking about how, oh my god, we don't know where he is, blah blah blah, rescue teams are searching. And then the second it gets announced that he and, like, his son, or his assistant or whatever, found, he just fucking shows up. And her fucking brother at his sister's apartment, where everybody is, watching the news. He's like, hey, what's up, guys? Like, it's so stupidly abrupt how from the announcement to him coming through the door, it is. Yeah, I don't know. That just made me laugh so hard when I had to see that. Oh yeah, I went and saw that on Valentine's Day. That was my gift to her. Was going to 50 Shades Darker. And because I went and saw that and I was a good boy and didn't ridicule it the whole time in the theater, I get to drag her to Ghost in the Shell later on this year. And that brings us right back to Dragon Ball, because I'm definitely interested in live action adaptations of anime and manga. There are rumors that a live-action JoJo's Bizarre Adventure movie is in the works, which that could be fucking crazy slash awful. Alright, so we got 3 of the 7. Let's get back into the match. Dragon Ball had its own live-action adaptation with Dragon Ball Evolution, which was lauded as a critical failure, and I don't know if you want to even call that a true adaptation. I've seen 60% of that movie, and it was not great. Just not. I mean, it wasn't awful, but it didn't feel like anything even close to Dragon Ball. Like, it felt like the CW's interpretation of Dragon Ball. Which is pretty funny because I think I'll have to look this up, but I'm pretty sure the actor who played Spike in Buffy the Vampire Slayer plays Piccolo. Well, King Piccolo, but anyway. As far as other live-action anime adaptations that I've seen, I saw the Death Note movies, well, the first two, and those were pretty goddamn good, I gotta say. Because they kept it nice and simple, and most of the budget was literally blown on CGI Shinigami. But they got good actors to play Light and L, and the script was solid, so that's all you really need in the story like that. I'm dying to see the Rurouni Kenshin live action movies. Because the first one just got a US release, which I'm super fucking stoked about. Trying to think of any other. Oh yeah, I haven't seen the anime, but Attack on Titan got a live action adaptation. That's another thing that I feel like I should check out at some point. I'm not getting any Dragon Balls in this one. Wonder if you could do a. I just thought about the idea of doing a One Piece live action movie, and there's no way in hell that would ever work. Every character in that fucking show looks like a goddamn cartoon. I don't know if you could ever adapt that. I can't remember if Bleach had any live action shit or not. I know, apparently people rave about the GTO live action series, because that was a huge thing in Japan. It got, like, some of the highest ratings for its finale in Japanese television history. Kian, Kian, Kian. No! God damn it. Alright, well, whatever. Fine. Fuck this bullshit. What else is going on? Let's see. Oh yeah, getting hyped for the Power Rangers movie. I recently got into the Boom Comics publication of the Mighty Morphin Power Rangers comics. Those are really good. It's kind of like a modern take on the original Mighty Morphin show. It's a little more adult oriented, and they barely like update it. The characters aren't really the same. They just give them the idea that okay, things like social media and smartphones and crap like that exist. And what would happen if those kids were growing up now? The books are strong. There's a brand new miniseries that's ongoing right now. I think issue 2 just came out this month, but they did a Justice League Mighty Morphin crossover. And issue 1 is so fucking strong. It's such a good dark little story where the Rangers literally get duped by Zed into destroying their own headquarters and getting stranded by a dimensional rift that happens when their teleporters malfunction in the DC universe. just the whole core conceit of what happens in the book is so damn strong. Oh, I'm super excited to keep reading that. And I think Power Rangers Pink just wrapped up, which my fiance is currently reading right now. I haven't actually picked that one up and started it. I'm trying to think of any other weird Deus Ex Machina stuff or other things, Dragon Ball or weird media related that I could jump into. Yeah, that Dragon Ball live action movie was just not good at all. It had a decent cast, and Chow Yun-fat as Grandpa Gohan, I think, was the character he played. Was he Grandpa Gohan or was he Master Roshi? I can't fucking remember. Oh my god, that movie is so fucking forgettable. They just set it all into high school, so it just feels like a god-awful... It's like, it's what I said, it's a god-awful CW show, but trying to be Dragon Ball. Ugh. Alright, let's see if you fools have a Dragon Ball for me. Have you seen this? Goddamn androids with tired Kamen Rider looking ass. Oh. If anybody knows where I can just stream episodes of the actual, like, original 70s Japanese Kamen Rider, I think it was in the 70s. I want to hear about that. Because Kamen Rider's fucking awesome. Just that character design and everything. Oh. Goddamn Grasshopper Man riding a motorcycle with a dope red scarf. That's the shit right there. I'm trying to remember off the top of my head how many Power Rangers spin-off things that there were back in the day. There's some really bad ones. VR Troopers and Big Bad Beetleborgs. What the fuck? There was Mystic Knights of Tyrannodogue. There was some really weird one that was on USA. And it was like almost like a weird Cinemax show because it was on late at night and had terrible acting, and just the camera shots were all fucking blown out and awful. I remember they merged up and transformed into some giant robot, this silver centurion looking man, to fight the monsters in the city. It's just awful. Oh god. God, I wanna Google that shit and see what the hell all that show was. Oh my god. I don't know if it's just because I've been into Power Rangers lately, but I feel like I've been on a Power Rangers kick talking about different stuff from that series on this stream. What's my favorite character from those shows? The original Green Ranger / White Ranger, Tommy Oliver, played by Jason David Frank. That actor is just... he's amazing. He's a real mixed martial artist. He goes around to... conventions and stuff like that. He's very proud of his... Oh, it's a Power Ranger. One of the, like, things that... God, I really want to look at this full IMDb to see all the things he's been. I distinctly remember him. When I was, like, growing up, and there was a show on MTV late at night. I think it was called Undressed or something like that. It was all weird, it was like a weird anthology series about different people, like, in weird late-night sex stuff. Like, there'd just be, like, stories about, like, college students trying to, like, hook up or whatever, and then, like, it just flashed, like, some girls in, like, a situation where they're all talking about different things that they'd, like, read up on or whatever, and it was just all these weird little sex stories. And good old JDF was in one where he was in a relationship with this power couple where they're two, like, business savvy people, and he's just really, like, focused on his 9-to-5, and his wife or fiance or whatever is trying to, like, get him to focus back on giving it to her proper. So the whole... the whole storyline of their little thing is that she's trying to get him to wear a cock ring that he bought, that she bought him. That's it. It's all about him trying to use a cock ring, and I think he does use it, and he has to, like, go to the hospital or something. Oh, God. I want to look that up now, see if I can find it and watch, like, just his bits on it. That was bad. Just the existence of that. Seeing him pop up in something else. And then he went right back to Power Rangers, where he was the Zordon mentor on, I think, Power Rangers Dino Force or whatever. Oh my god. I think we're at 4 Dragon Balls. Oh my god. Fuck, what else is going on? We are slowly but surely rolling out videos on the Co-Optionalism show on the channel Full Spectrum Gaming on YouTube. We've got episode 1 from Rodea the Sky Soldier up. We've got episode 1 from Castlevania 3 Dracula's Curse up. And we recently posted episode 1 of our playthrough of Mickey Mouse's World of Illusion. All of those videos are pretty damn enjoyable if you ever find yourself in the YouTube-verse. Give him a go. This guy has a poop stick on his back. Alright. I do not remember a pink poop being part of Dragon Ball. Maybe that was part of the original Dragon Ball and I just didn't see it, so I pretty much jumped on at Z, but okay, I'll buy that for a dollar, that's fine. Somebody had a poop wand. That's fair. Of all the shit that's happened in that series, I believe that somebody had a poop wand. A fucking pig used the power of being able to wish for anything in the universe. To wish for the world's most comfortable pair of underwear. And he got a pair of pink panties. You know, that's a thing. That's a thing that can happen when you look at a fucking wish-granting dragon and ask a dumb question. Or make a dumb request, I mean. Oh my god. A major villain in that series turned people into candy and ate them. I mean, Shit just. Media's weird sometimes, I swear. Yeah, let's just talk about how batshit crazy Lucha Underground was not too long ago, and now I'm talking about how crazy Dragon Ball in general is. Like, if you're not familiar, the naming mechanics of Dragon Ball are fucking insane. Several characters are named after fruits and vegetables. There's an entire family that's named after undergarments. Professor Brief has his daughter, who is Goku's good friend, who in the American dub is called Bulma, but her original name was, I believe, Bloomer or Bloomers. Then she has a son with space alien Vegeta, which is vegetable. Which, their son is named Trunks. And then I believe later they have a daughter named Bra. Ugh. Just. What the fuck? What the actual fuck? And I don't even understand the Namekian naming conventions, because you've got Piccolo and Nail, which are just things. And then other Namekians have just fucking weird names, like I don't know what Dende is, I have no idea what. Well, I mean, a guru is just a person. Kami is another word for God. Alright, so we got that Dragon Ball. Yeah, all the Saiyans, the core Saiyans, are named after fucking vegetables. Except I think fucking Brawly and Bardock. But yeah, Goku's given birth name is Kakarot, which is carrot. Their planet, and Vegeta's father and Vegeta himself are named Vegeta for vegetable. Nappa is a type of cabbage. Raditz means radish. Oh, I just. All of this for a weird sci-fi interpretation of Journey to the West. Which, that's always just amazed me. This is all supposed to be an adaptation of Journey to the West. Which, if you want to see a closer adaptation in anime of Journey to the West, go watch Sayuki, even though that show is way up its own ass, it's at least truer to the actual core conceit of Journey to the West. Because let's see. In Dragon Ball, Krillin is supposed to be Sanzo. And Goku's obviously Son Goku. Oolong's the boar, and I mean, is Piccolo the fucking water spirit? The Kappa? I don't get any of it. Oh well. Anyway. Well, I'm just gonna get hit by Kamehameha, because that sounds fun. Alright. Yep, And you're gonna do that, and I'm gonna do this, and get completely countered. Mostly because it'll usually end like that. Somehow summoned a Shenron style wishing dragon. Yeah, there's no dragon left. Good. I mean, what do you do? Do you wish for something selfish? Do you wish for something good? I never understood on Dragon Ball. I mean, they're always using the stupid Dragon Balls to wish their friend back to life after some cosmic threat shows up. Some fucking alien and beats the shit out of their whole home. Destroys a bunch of shit. In some cases, destroys a whole fucking planet. And then they just end up wishing their friend back from the dead, or wishing for the people of the planet that got destroyed to have a new fucking planet to call their home. Wouldn't you just wish for assholes to not destroy things? Or... since, like, the Z-Force is supposed to be guys protecting Earth. Hey, before some new alien comes, we just want to wish that Earth doesn't get destroyed by some unnatural cataclysm / asshole. Just... that's a deus ex machina right there. Just unmaking the conceit of everything because you can. Because you have access to a fucking wish dragon. And I get it, the whole conceit of the show would be blown apart if there wasn't some fucking constant threat to show up to make the characters get stronger and get new abilities and blah blah blah, yucky schmackety. Yeah, I don't know if I said blah blah blah, yucky schmackety in like decades. Fucking Tasmania. Alright. Where are we at on the Dragon Ball Hunt? We are gonna summon that dragon tonight, I guarantee goddamn it. Alright. Got animals going over here, fast food. Oh fuck, we are one Dragon Ball away from this goal. It is about to be on. Like old Shenron. Not now, go back. I want that weak-ass Goku. I fought the Lord of Destruction Beerus Goku. Trained with fucking Whis and some other fucking realm Goku. God, that is some shit, though. I haven't even watched that much of Dragon Ball Super, but the idea that some fucking threat shows up that you actively need the power of Super Saiyan God to fight. Oh my god. That shit's gotta be up its own ass. Alright. I keep wondering if that Ghost in the Shell movie is gonna be good or not.
I mean, I'm gonna go see it in theaters and give it some money, so I'm hoping it's gonna be goddamn good. It's just one of those things that it's been in the works for so long and passed through so many hands. It's kind of like the idea of somebody trying to do a live action adaptation of Akira. I don't know if you should even fuck with that. But maybe it can be done now. I don't know. I would love to see somebody take another real, proper swing at something like Dragon Ball. Yeah, I don't know, maybe it's too far up its own ass and too convoluted to do. I'd be interested to see what they're gonna do with this live-action JoJo's Bizarre Adventure movie in Japan. But Japanese live-action, if it's a grounded story, it feels like it works. Like the whole Death Note thing, where there really isn't too much special effects going on. It's a character piece. JoJo requires so much in special effects that I don't know if you can do that properly in Japanese cinema. Like, I think you have to maybe get Japanese actors and a director partnered up with, like, an American studio so you can have some proper effects for stands and hormone fighting and all that shit. I would be way down to see just every part of the JoJo saga adapted. Oh fuck, I need to get caught up on JoJo, that's another fucking thing I need to do. JoJo's Bizarre Adventure is such a weird fucking thing. I'm still in the middle of the third season of that show. I've been hearing crazy things about Diamond and Breakable, the fourth season, but I think that was the fourth season. Oh my god. I am getting my shit rocked right now, that's just incredible. You better have a fucking Dragon Ball in there for all this ass whooping you're putting on the shirt. Material. Yes! Alright, perfect. Complete this mission, and then we are off to the Dragon Pedestal. They've been pretty good time, I'd say. I mean, even dicking around and finishing off the missions where I didn't actually get a Dragon Ball, we were just under an hour. And all things considered, with the way that this game is structured, you should not really be able to collect Dragon Balls that fast. But what do you know? Leave it to somebody like your friend Kifulu to just completely exploit a system like that. Alright, come on Goku, show up. Do a thing. Throw out some voice acting that I'm not letting anybody hear. Alright. Piccolo's already dead. Really? Hit me with my own fucking ally. You son of a bitch, come here. How dare past you throw future you at me? Oh my god. You actually killed Super Saiyan God Zero.
Yeah, Goku just really will always whoop Vegeta's ass.
Oh, canon. Alright. And the 6-star Dragon Ball. Doot doot do. Looks like we did it. In 55 minutes. It's pretty damn good. Let's see what happens. Oh my god. Alright. So when you collect all the Dragon Balls, you get to go to this fun little place up here. And if you're dope as hell like me and have your flying permit, it's way easy to do. I think just because I don't really care at this point, let's just turn something back on real quick. No, not
hey,
that.
Hey, it's me, Goku!
There it is. Hi. Okie dokie. And a big old dragon about to fly out of the bullshit. Sorry, God, if it's like blocked scene, I'm gonna fuck it. I'm gonna get real pissed. The whole point of my stupid stream gets undone right there. Oh, hi Shenron. Oh, look at you with your cute Chinese dragon mustache.
Go on, wish.
Oh, you just got
what
mad.
What is your wish?
You do not like the fact that I am just really good at getting all these fucking. Let's see. I want to get stronger. I want to grow. I want to ultimate attack. I want to super attack. I want a second chance at life. I want to be drop dead gorgeous.
On
medals. I want to dress up more. I want another new ultimate attack. I want a full stomach.
I
want a rare item butthole.
A very easy wish.
See, normally it also shows you how to. Or it gives you the thing for
I have
extra characters.
Your wish.
I've already unlocked all those extra characters with wishes. So Shenron won't give me that anymore. But that's it. Like I said, you're here at my Twitch channel, Cthulhu Gaming. I believe it's the same tag to find me on YouTube. My core channel with my good friend Corey is Full Spectrum Gaming on YouTube, and you can also see me showing up on his Twitch streams, which he streams under the moniker of Cyclosis51. Check that stuff out. I'm gonna sign off for right now. Thanks for tuning in. One person that's on the stream right now, which I can't really look at because I'm on the stupid PlayStation stuff. But thank you very much. I'll Vita Zen, and I will talk to all y'alls later. Thanks for tuning in.